So we've all heard about how fantastic the new M1 chip is. First with the M1 MacBook Air and Pro, then the Mac Mini, and following that with the iMac 24-inch. Now we have them in the iPad Pros. Although the reason for having them inside the iPad can be a matter of conjecture, and my guess would be that it's got to do with the economics of chip production for Apple. But all the same, it's a welcome move and really speeds up what was already a very speedy system. So in this video, I wanted to explore what you can't do with your iPad, M1 or not. This will be a really interesting way for anyone considering one of these machines to evaluate whether they are suitable for your requirements and whether they can actually replace a laptop if you're considering doing that. Bear in mind that this is not meant in any way to bash these fantastic tablets. On the contrary, iPads are the only tablets that I recommend for anyone. However, on certain aspects, we need to keep our expectations in check, and that is exactly what we will explore in this video. The first thing that you cannot do with an iPad, or for that matter any iOS device, is surf using desktop class web browsers with plugins. If you use a plugin or rely on a plugin for any work-related activity, you're out of luck. Now with a Mac or PC, this is not an issue at all. You can fire up your preferred browser and simply run the extensions you want. If you try and use the Chrome browser with the iPad, you will sometimes just be forced to open the app, or sometimes you will not be able to open it via the browser. You will instead see a warning about the same. The next thing you cannot do with an iPad is format any external hard drive. Now this may or may not be a big issue for you, and if you do not use a lot of external hard drives and you primarily work off the cloud, then this isn't an issue. But the iPad simply doesn't offer many options in here. All you can do is literally just kind of browse whatever you've connected onto the iPad, and there is no way to format a drive. So if you get something that isn't formatted in a format that you can write to, you're not able to format that at all using the iPad. The third thing you cannot do with an iPad is have a USB connection to a legacy printer. If you try searching for printers within the settings, you will not come up with anything on the iPad, and there are tons of options when you go to a Mac or a PC. You can obviously look up the supply levels on the printer to see what kind of ink levels you have. You also have access to other utilities like the printer's utility to be able to check on the print heads, to clean the print heads, align the print heads, and do various functions related to printers. So if this is something that you wanted to do, you're out of luck if you're using an iPad. It simply does not offer any functionality when it comes to printers. The fourth thing you cannot do at the moment with an iPad is run a different operating system. Although here there have been recent developments and there were methods available previously as well that allowed you to do this, but except for a now defunct method using UTM, all of those methods required you to connect to a remote desktop or cloud PC. Now this is not necessarily a bad thing and may even be the way forward in the future. But for natively running a different OS on your machine, you're out of luck. Sure, it's not straightforward to do this with any M1 Mac at the moment, but at least there are ways to accomplish this and the situation should improve in the future. The fifth thing that you cannot do with an iPad is connect to an external monitor and extend your display. That means once you connect the display, all you will see is a mirrored version of what's on your iPad. Pretty much useless on such a large display. The next thing you cannot do with an iPad is write to NTFS or FAT formatted drives.
Well, first of all, some hard drives that require too much power to be drawn may not work correctly with this. So this particular 4 TB hard drive from WD isn't functioning at all on here, so it's not appearing. It requires a lot of power, so even though it appears to be spinning, I can see the light and feel the vibration inside the disc. It's not actually showing up on the iPad itself. So let's try instead with this Seagate drive. This is 5 TB, but we might have better luck with this. Okay, there we are. So it has successfully got into this particular hard drive. So this particular hard drive is formatted in a format that's friendly with the iPad so it can write to it. But if you were to connect an NTFS or FAT32 drive, you can only read from it and not create new folders or write any files to it. So if you use a lot of Windows PCs as well as a mix of Mac computers and you want your iPad to coexist in that system, this may not be the right choice.
The seventh thing that you cannot do reliably with an iPad is to upload files to certain websites that have a Chrome or Internet Explorer bias.
Now this has been admittedly a bit difficult for me to replicate, but there are some sites that just don't like the Safari running on the iPad and they will not allow you to upload stuff. And the only workaround is really to use a proper desktop PC because it simply refuses to work on the iPad.
The next thing you cannot do with an iPad is have a dedicated download manager that can speed up your downloads considerably. Although there are apps available that have inbuilt download functionality that works better than the Safari browser, it is still no replacement for a desktop class downloader that can really, really speed up downloads. And finally, one last thing that the iPad cannot do is run a huge catalog of Pro apps available to both Macs and Windows. There has been almost endless discussions on this and we know there are great substitutes available for iPadOS, but for certain tasks you just need those desktop class apps like Final Cut Pro, etc. I'm not even talking about people that rely on certain Windows apps, but just the usual ones that are either available for Macs or across desktop platforms. Now it was important to make this video before I give you my full review of the M1 iPad Pro, which will follow soon. This way, if any of these are deal breakers for you, you can either skip buying or upgrading to an M1 iPad Pro or at least make an informed decision. Hope you found this video useful and be sure to check out the M1 iPad Pro playlist and watch out for the full review coming soon. If you're interested in Macs or iPhones, do check out their playlists as well. Links in the description. Thanks for watching and I will see you in my next one.